time to open your word and to hear from your spirit. Lord, we desire that you give us ears to hear and a heart to obey what you would tell your people this morning. Lord, we love you and we thank you for your word and your guidance in it. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we are continuing in John chapter 14. I'm echoing a little bit here. So we're in John chapter 14. And last time, we got to verse 7. So we're going to refresh on verses 5 through 7. So we're starting in John chapter 14, verse 5. Jesus had told them that where I go, you know, and the way you know. Well, in verse 5, Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Verse 8, Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Now it seems on the surface that this is a reasonable request. Not only is it a reasonable request, but this is the highest honor. This is the greatest glory that any man or woman can ask for. Show us the Father. As Christians, do we realize that our goal, our hope, isn't to go to heaven, to walk on the streets of gold, to see the pearly gates, to visit our loved ones who've passed on before? Our goal in going to heaven is to be with the one who died for us and gives us access to be with the Father. Our heart's desire, our driving goal of our life should be, one day I will stand before my Jesus who gives me access to the Father, and I'll see him face to face. So what Philip was asking for was entirely reasonable. And not only that, but in the Gospel of John, Jesus refers to the Father 124 times, over twice that of any of the other Gospels. Now it's interesting, as we've talked before, the four different Gospels are written towards different groups of people. The Gospel of John is written primarily focused towards the church. And it's interesting that its desire, its goal, is to portray Jesus Christ as God eternal, God the Son, who died on the cross, and gives us the power to call God the Father, Abba Father. It's just so interesting to watch the Holy Spirit's fingers at work in all these subtle details. And the one gospel that's given specifically aimed towards us, over 124 times, Jesus gives us the example that God is our Father. Now, for those of us who didn't have an awesome example growing up, that could be challenging. But the bottom line, God is the greatest example. God wants to be our Father. Each and every one. God doesn't have grandkids, you know that? Every child of the King is a child of the King. A first rate, first generation, face to face, child of the King. Amen? So what Philip asked him was reasonable. And even in this passage section here, Jesus refers to the Father over 20 times, just in these next few verses. And he calls, as I said, Jesus calls us to relate to God the Father as our Father. So Philip's request, being the highest aspiration anyone can have, the end goal of the Christian, what's surprising is in verse 9, Jesus gives him a little bit of a rebuke. Verse 9 says, Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and yet you've not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father. Now we need to be aware that Jesus' rebuke to Philip wasn't his request to see the Father. His rebuke was Jesus had been showing him the Father all along, and he didn't see it. He didn't recognize it. In fact, right before Philip asked a question, Jesus had given a promise. Verse 7 is a promise. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. That's a promise. Now, when you break down the language, what it says is, from now on, right now, this instant, it's revealed to you. You are staring at him clearly. It's the most emphatic you can get. Jesus is telling Philip, from now on, you know the Father and you see him. You can see him. You're looking at him. The Father is in me and I in him. He'll continue on. So that's a promise to us. That was a promise to the disciples, and that's a promise to us. We know the heart of the Father because Jesus has given us the picture. We know the desires of the Father's heart because Jesus has made them clear to us. Amen? Yeah. In verse 10, Jesus says, "Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the work." I want to talk about this for just a minute. The Father who dwells in me does the work. Now, typically, I don't know about you guys, hopefully you won't tell me I'm the only one, but typically, I view the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit as separate, and they are. Scripture tells us they are separate persons. They're one, they're the Trinity. But because I'm human, and my head can only wrap around so many things, I tend to think of, like the baptism of Christ. There was Jesus, he was baptized, the Holy Spirit came down as a dove, and the voice of the Father was heard from heaven. So I tend to think of Jesus here, the Father there, and the Holy Spirit there. Jesus kind of blows all that away and shatters our preconceived notions when he says, "The Father dwells in me who does the work." That begins to make sense when he was on the cross and he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Because never before had the Son and the Father been separate. Even when Christ was incarnate in a body, the Father dwelt with him in spirit. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit were in constant communication always until the cross. It was in that moment when Jesus became sin for us that the Father turned his back on him, because he had to, because that was our punishment. That's what we deserved. So much for preconceived notions. The Father who dwells in me does the work. Jesus attributes all of the works that he did to the Father, just as we attribute the works that we do to the Son. Jesus said, "Without me, you can do nothing," right? Not a little bit. Nothing. Without Jesus Christ, we can do nothing. Any of the works that we do glorify him. Our purpose in glorifying him is that he glorifies the Father. And we glorify the Father through him. It's quite amazing that, as we spoke a couple of weeks ago, God prepares works for us to do, empowers us to do it, does it through us, and then rewards us for that. It's kind of a mind blower, but that's the way he set it up. So Jesus attributes all of the works that he does to the Father. So as we go forward, as we think about Christ, keep that in mind, that the Father dwelt in him. Just as the Holy Spirit dwells in us and Christ dwells in us, the Father dwelt in the Son and the Son in the Father. Hard to get your head around, I know, but being human, we can only get so far. The Holy Spirit has to open our eyes, and sometimes we don't get it, but we have to accept it in faith. Amen. Verse 11. Jesus said, "Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the work themselves." This is quite different than signs and wonders. We've talked before that signs and wonders that Jesus Christ did gave validity to his words. We've also talked that you can't go after signs and wonders because Jesus said a wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign. Signs and wonders can be lying signs and wonders. But the works, the fruit, is either a good tree or a bad tree. And Jesus is saying, if you don't believe that I am in the Father, look at the works that I'm doing. The works that I am doing are scriptural, are from the Father. We can look at the works in our life. We can look at what we're doing. If it lines up with Scripture, we know the Spirit's working through our life. If we examine our life and there's no fruit, if our life is the same as it was before we came to Christ and there's no difference, time to get on our knees and start praying. Lord, I'm not seeing any fruit here. It's his job to produce fruit. It's our job to be obedient. Amen? All right. So, believe me that I'm in the Father and the Father's in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also. And greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. This is quite a mind-blowing statement, because over the course of this book of John, we have looked at some of the miracles that Jesus did. Literally life-changing. He's raised the dead. He's brought the sick back to life, or back to wholeness. He's healed the lame. He's given sight to the blind. All these things that Jesus has done, he said, you'll do the same. And you'll do greater than these. Now, that doesn't mean better. That means more of. Kind of think of it as greater coverage. It's not greater than better. It's greater as in larger. Larger volume. And where that comes into play is in one term. It's called the body of Christ. Now, when Jesus was here, he was in one place at one time. He went to heal a person. He went over here to preach the gospel. One place at one time. But what he's done is create what is called the body of Christ. If you turn to Colossians chapter 2, verses 18 and 19, we'll look at that briefly. Colossians chapter 2, verses 18 and 19. Colossians chapter 2, verse 18 says, "Let no one cheat you of your reward, taking delight in false humility and worship of angels, intruding into those things which he's not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind, and not holding fast to the head, from whom all the body, nourished and knit together by joints and ligaments, grows with the increase that is from God." When you understand as much as you can about how God has created our bodies, our physical bodies, are knit together. Cells and ligaments and joints and muscles. It's the exact same way he described his church. His church, his body. We are his body. He's in heaven right now. But the works that he began to do, he's completing through his church, his body. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, please, beginning in verse 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning in verse 1. "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore I made known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Catch that. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. Every gift that we have among the body, the gift that Jesus has given you, the gift, the spiritual gift that the Holy Spirit has given you as a believer, is to be used among the body for the edification of it all. What's the most important part on your body? It's usually the one that's not working. I don't know about you guys, but the older I get, the more parts I have that don't work right. You know, when I go to grab a hold of something and give a tug and this part doesn't work or that part's hurting, that's the most important part, is the one that's not working or hurting. It's the same among the body. The most important member in our body is the one that's hurt or the one that's not working, the one that needs attention. That's the most important part. You know, that's how we minister to each other in love, you know, considering one another as more important than ourselves. Those who need us, that's where we go. If they need help, we help them, because everything we do as a body affects the rest of us. Amen. Sorry, I kind of like lost my track. Verse 5. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. No, I'm sorry, verse 8. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healings by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another different kind of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each individually as he wills. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I'm not a hand, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I'm not an ear, I'm not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body, just as he pleased. You know, we can honestly pray every day, every time, any place, that we are in such a time as this because God put us here. We are in such a place as this because God put us here. God doesn't roll the dice. He doesn't play by accident. If we're children of the King, if we're Christians, if we're listening to the Spirit, if we're being obedient, we are where we are because he put us there for such a time as this. And we need to be working. We need to be using the gifts that he's given us to use among those he's given us to work with. We all have a part to play. Nobody's part is any more important than anybody else's part. Some are more visible. Some are more behind the scenes. In fact, I believe most of the time those behind the scenes are more important than the ones in the front. There is no unimportant part in the body, no unimportant part in the kingdom. It's all critical. Where was I? Okay, 19. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. And the eye can't say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, much rather, those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor, and our unrepresentable parts have greater modesty. But our presentable parts have no need, but God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are the body of Christ and members individually. And God has appointed these in the church: First apostles, second prophets, third teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, administrations, varieties of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Do all have gifts of healings? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I show you a more excellent way. In chapter 13, he goes on to say the more excellent way is love. And he shows us clearly that fighting over, stressing over, fussing over various gifts shows a lack of love among the body. That the greatest is love. The greatest commandment, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Everything has to be done in love. If we fuss and fight over gifts among the body, we're not being loving. And we're certainly not understanding the way God has set the body up. As I said, there are some in the front. There are some behind. There are some behind the scenes. There are some you'll never hear about. They'll be given just as much glory and honor, and possibly, probably more than the ones you see. Because God has set up for all in his kingdom to do their part, and the rewards are due to faithful service, not popularity. And not popularity. I'll leave it at that. So if you would, back to John 14. It's that way. It's because God has built, through the Holy Spirit, a body that covers the world, that we can do greater works, greater meaning larger in volume. We can pray for someone across the world in India, and now we can actually watch them on our phone. We can look at someone on the opposite side of the world and hit our knees in prayer for them, for the Holy Spirit to meet their needs right now. It's an amazing time to live. God's body, Christ's body, is able to reach anywhere in this world because that's the way he's building it. And just as our physical bodies obey our mind, the church body obeys the head, which is Christ. Where he sends us, we go. What he requests that we do, we do. And the purpose of that is to edify the body and to reach the lost for Jesus Christ. Amen? So back to John 14, verse 12. Jesus says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father." Now we'll see later that it's because he's going to the Father that he will be able to send the Holy Spirit. And it's the Holy Spirit who builds that body. Verse 13, "And whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." Now, in my opinion, this is one of the most abused passages in the Bible, and misunderstood and mistaught. What does it mean to pray or to ask in Jesus' name? Is that a tag that we throw on the end of our sentence to get what we want? It's like rubbing the genie's lamp. Oh, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, oh, by the way, in Jesus' name. You know, I've done that myself. And I'm sure each and every one of you have. No prayer, blah, blah, blah. Oh, yeah, by the way, in Jesus' name. Bless this food in Jesus' name. Not even thinking about the food, not even thinking about Jesus, not even thinking about God. It's routine. It's what we do. And we put in Jesus' name on the end of it. That's not what it means. For an example, let's use the Roman Empire. When a governor or a procurator or any ruler in the Roman government would come into an area and begin to govern, he came in the name of Caesar. And if he showed up in the name of Caesar, you better be obedient, because he was standing in the place of Caesar. Now, in order to get that authority, they would spend years with Caesar. They would understand what he would do in a given situation. How would he would rule in this particular court scenario? They would learn everything they possibly could about Caesar, so that when they went out in his name, they acted exactly the way Caesar would act. There's no surprises. That's what it means to pray or ask for something in Jesus' name. When we ask for something in the name of the Lord, we are standing in Jesus' place. Think about standing at the Father's throne and saying, Father, I pray, I desire, I ask for this certain thing. I ask for this person's healing. I ask for this person's financial burden to be met. I ask for this loss to be saved. I ask for my children to have a daughter. You know, whatever we're asking, think about that. We're asking the Father as if we're Jesus. And the reason the Father can say no is because sometimes we're not asking for something that Jesus would be asking for. Sometimes we're asking things, I should be honest, Father, I want this. I'm not really certain Jesus would ask for this. This is what I'm really wanting right now. And that's why your will be done and not mine. Because Jesus only asks for the things that are perfect and edifying and necessary and good for us. Sometimes I ask for things that might not be good for me because I'm not God and I don't know the future. And sometimes I ask for things that aren't good for me just because I want something that's not good for me. We got to be honest with ourselves and honest with God in our prayers. When we pray in Jesus' name, what we're saying is we're praying in Jesus' authority, in his spirit, in his attitude, in his desire, in his place. If we ask the Father for something that Jesus would ask for, we will receive it, guaranteed. Because Jesus has made that promise. And as I said, if we ask for something and the Lord says no, then it wasn't his will. It might be a maybe later. It might be a maybe way later. But we have to preface our prayers with your desire, your will be done. We're standing in Jesus' name, in his spirit. And if we do that, then he'll answer our prayers. It's a guarantee. But he also links that to verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. You see, there is no loophole in Scripture anywhere for lack of obedience. Just because we're saved by grace, we do not have license to sin. We need to confess our sins to the Lord. We need to repent. We need to visit 1 John 1:9 often. He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins if we confess them and to cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. There is no loophole. There is no excuse for disobedience. If you love me, keep my commandments. Now, it's kind of hard to misteach that. That's pretty clear. If you love me, keep my commandments. If we are living in Jesus' name, we will be keeping his commandments. The same attitude in our prayers should apply in our lives. If we are living in Jesus' name, if we are doing what he would have us do, if we are living the way he would have us live, we will keep his commandments. Verse 16, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. Now that word another is different. It's allos. It means another as in different. Now, Greek is really precise. There are words that mean I will give you another one, which is exactly the same. You know, I'll give you a blue pencil with a, you know, red eraser. I want another one exactly the same. And there's a word like allos, another pencil, but it's not the same. Jesus said, I will pray the Father and he will give you another helper, comforter, the Parakletos, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God, but he's not Jesus. Jesus is God, but he's not the Holy Spirit, and neither one of them are the Father. Jesus prays to the Father, and he will send the Holy Spirit, the Parakletos. Now, we know that happened in Acts chapter 2, day of Pentecost. He says that he may abide with you forever. How long is forever? kind of forever. Long, long, long time. Now, in the Greek, being so precise that he may abide with you forever, it actually says unto perpetuity. Starts now, goes through this life, and then whatever's next, it's still there. And then whatever's next after that, he's still there. And if there's more after that, he's still there. Amen. He will never leave us. He will never forsake us. Now, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come and go. You know, David prayed after his mess with Bathsheba. And Lord, please don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Samson had an issue. He gave up the hair, lost the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit would come and go on the Old Testament saints. He does not do that among the church, folks. The Holy Spirit takes up residence in our heart when we accept Christ as Lord and Savior, and he's there, and he remains. Now, we might grieve him, so he goes silent for a while. We might be a bit stubborn, so he has to convict us. He might have to take us to the woodshed, but what he doesn't do is leave us. The Holy Spirit will not leave a believer. We can't pray, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. What we can pray is, I'm sorry if I've grieved you because I can't hear you anymore. And if you can't hear this Holy Spirit anymore, that should grieve you. There's times that we have a silent period in our life because the Lord wants to know, do you trust me? Do you love me even if it's silent? Like he did with Abraham. He gave him a promise and then he was silent for a while. He'll do the same with us. He'll tell us what he wants. He'll give us some direction. And then he might be silent for a while to see, do you love me and do you trust me when it's not coming around as fast as you think it should? When you're not hearing what you think you should hear, do you still love me? Do you still trust me? So don't be surprised if that happens. But also sometimes he gets quiet when we're stubborn and bullheaded and we're being rebellious and we don't want to repent. We don't want to do what he's telling us to do. So it'll grieve the Spirit, and he might sit back quietly for a while until we come around to our senses. But either way, it's a dry, dry, dry place when we're not hearing from the Lord. Amen. I don't like it. So he comes to abide with us forever. Verse 17 is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. The Holy Spirit had been with the disciples all along, bearing witness to Jesus' words and to his works, which is exactly the same thing he does today. The Holy Spirit walks beside us to bring us to Christ. He opens the Word. He convicts through the Word that Jesus Christ is the Lord. Once you come to Christ, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in our heart. Then he's within us. But there's one more experience, and that's when he comes upon you. That was Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit came upon them. The church was born to empower them for works of service. And he does the same thing today. Just because we're born again, and just because we receive the Spirit when we're born again, doesn't mean we're done. Because the Lord, when he puts us to work, we need to be empowered. There is never a time that it's inappropriate to pray, Lord, fill me again with your Spirit. Or Lord, come upon me in power to do your work. You know, Jerry and I, years ago, we were out witnessing, we went to the mall, and we went in this store that was a psychic palm reading thing, and I got to take, yeah, thank you, the pit of hell, and I got to take a hit on the jaw because it was me that drug us in there. I'm walking along, we're talking, we're praying. I had no idea what the store was. I'd never seen this thing before. I don't go to malls. I don't go to stores. These clothes appear in my closet. Thank you, Jesus, and my wife, Sue. They're just there. I don't do those things. So we're walking along, and here's a store, and I was pulled in like with a hook. And I walked in, and a beeline straight to the back. When I got to the back of the building, there was a window. It was a little office. And through the window, I could see a young woman with a child on one side of the table. On the other side of the table was a medium. And they had tarot cards and a crystal ball and all this stuff on that table. And I'm telling you, folks, what was going on in that room was not a trick, was not a game, was not a hoax. That was straight from the pits of hell, satanic. It was horrifying watching what looked in anyone else's eyes just to be a harmless reading of the cards. But the Lord showed me the horror in the spiritual realm that was going on in that place. What I didn't know is as we walked in, Jerry saw the woman at the counter. Was like, just as we walked by, it was like she got shocked. Like, and she watched us like hawks, everything we did. That only had to be the Spirit of the Lord because we didn't know what was going on. But the point is, we were just in there a few minutes, and I was trying to pray for that woman, and my head was fuzzy, and it was just the strangest thing, and we said, we got to get out of here. So we left the place, and we kind of regrouped afterwards, and like, what's going on in there? Like, I don't know, but I'm so weary, I don't know if I can walk to the car. Literally felt completely drained, wiped out. Reason being, we weren't prayed up. I wasn't prayed up. I was not ready. I went out with my brothers witnessing and praying for the lost. I wasn't prayed up. I wasn't ready. I was not ready to do the warfare that God would have sent me to do. I didn't do that the second time. There was prayer and fasting when we talked about going back the second time because the Lord used that as a prime example. Yes, He will protect us. Yes, we are His children. But we need to be prayed up, and we need to be as full as much of the Holy Spirit as He wants to pour into us for the work that He's going to do. Because the second time we went back, it was a joyous occasion. We got to pray with a lot of people, and we didn't feel that wiped out when we were done. So just a small example. The Holy Spirit will come upon us to empower us for service. The gifts that He puts in our lives, don't be afraid of them. Don't be afraid of them. Submit to the Holy Spirit just as you do to the Son and to the Father. Because He only wants to do what's best for you and for the body. And those gifts that He prepares, the old King James says He gives severally. I like that. That means specifically, individually, tailored for you. The gifts that the Lord has given you, I can't use. Or you can't use them. You can't use mine. The Lord has given each and every believer specific spiritual gifts to use for His glory and His kingdom. If you don't use them, no one else will. Use them. Simple as that. You know, what has the Lord called me to do? What's He put on your heart to do? Whatever He puts on your heart to do, say, Lord, in Your strength and Your will and Your power and the power of Your Holy Spirit, I go. Okay. All right. Verse 18. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. A little while longer and the world will see me no more, but you will see me because I live, you will live also. Now, we don't have to turn there, but make a note that in Genesis 24, is a beautiful picture of the church in advance. Abraham sends his unnamed servant, which we know who his servant was. It's Eleazar, which means comforter. Abraham sends his servant to go get a bride for his wife. And he sends them back to his homeland, not among the heathen. Go back. Okay. So, long story short, go back to Genesis 24 and read it. As Eleazar the servant goes and finds Rebekah and brings her back to Isaac, along the way he gives her gifts. treasures, and he puts a ring in her nose, and he gets her ready to meet Isaac. The net result is, by the time she sees Isaac, she's already in love with him before she's ever laid eyes on him. And she jumps off the camel, and he runs to meet her, and they're madly in love before they ever meet. Because the comforter, the servant, has taught her through this whole journey how wonderful her husband's going to be. How glorious the king. Is there any in here who are born again believers who aren't excited to meet Jesus and have no idea what he looks like? Never laid eyes on him, but we know we will. Don't know what he looks like, and we don't care. We've never seen him in person, but we know how wonderful he is because the Holy Spirit walks with us, talks with us, and teaches us our entire journey as a Christian to prepare us for that day when we stand face to face with him. Whew, hallelujah. So go back and read Genesis 24. That's pretty cool. So back to John 14:20. At that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. So what day is he talking about? He's talking about Acts chapter 2. He's talking about when the Holy Spirit falls upon the church. Then we'll realize. Then Philip will finally get the picture. Philip will understand that the Father dwells in the Son, and the Son with the Father, and as I am in you, and you in me. And that day he'll know. And it's the same with us. The Holy Spirit makes Jesus Christ as real to us as anyone we've ever met. More real, in fact. How many people throughout the centuries have given up their head, lost their lives, lost children, lost family, lost homes, lost everything they had, given it up for a man they've never met because the Holy Spirit has given them assurance that they are the child of God and that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Amen. Verse 21, Jesus goes on, and he who has my commandments and keeps them is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. And Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words. And the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. The Holy Spirit will bring to remembrance all things that Christ said to us. He will open his word. Now, there's a couple of things we need to notice. Jesus says, he who has my commandments and keeps them. That's a two-part. Number one, we need to have the desire to know what his commandments are. We need to have them. And then we need to be obedient. Now, there's many that think, if I don't know, I won't be held accountable. That's not so. Still be held accountable. But those who love Jesus, we want to know what he says. And we find it right here. We want to know what his commandments are. We want to know what his heart is. We want to know what his will and his desire for us is. And we find it here in the word. And the Holy Spirit opens that word to us and makes it real. And then we can have his commandments and keep them. Amen. All right. And with that, we'll close today. I'd like to encourage anyone who wants to pray with me afterwards, if you've kind of hit a dry spot, maybe you feel that's it's a good time for a refreshing in the Lord, come up and pray. If you don't know the Lord, today is the day of salvation. I'll be bold enough to say, if you don't know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, You might not get tomorrow. You have today, you have now, but you might not get tomorrow. So if you want to pray to receive the Lord, come up and see me afterwards too. And if there's any who are out on the airwaves who listen to us through YouTube or any other places that we're broadcasting, I'd encourage you today as I pray to dismiss. If you want to accept the Lord, pray with me and confess your sins and accept Christ as Lord and Savior, and your life will be changed, I promise. So let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your Holy Spirit, who you promised has come to teach us all things about you. And we'll, in the upcoming weeks, we'll begin to know more and more as you reveal your glory, as you reveal your heart's desire to teach us and to equip us and to empower us to do your works in your kingdom. Lord, I would pray for anyone out there who's listening and they're on the fence as to whether or not they want to accept this Jesus, and is it worth it? I would encourage your Spirit, Lord, to show them how worthy Christ is and what the alternative is, the reality. So if you're out there listening and you want to accept Christ today, the Bible's very clear, it's very simple, that if you confess the Lord Jesus Christ and believe that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Simple as that. Confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and you shall be saved. If you're out there and you're feeling a bit dry, I would pray that you would just seek the Lord. Just ask him, Lord, pour your Spirit out on me again. Refill me, Lord. Refresh me. Give me a new love. Give me a new joy. Give me a new excitement. Give me new power to do your works so that we can glorify our Lord and Savior and our Father in heaven. We thank you in Jesus' name.